I'll be more than willing, because there's so much to be said about our state, Kogi State.
I think we should say it now, because this is the time.
Sir,
how do you feel about the state, Kogi, right now? What's going on? We've seen what Governor Yabelo is doing. There are a lot of perception that things are not normal, the way it's supposed to be. And then some people are saying, oh, it is okay. But you are in the opposition. You have just lost the government to him or to their party. What do you feel as a former deputy governor and someone that a lot of people feel will also be in that seat?
You see, I'm so happy that you qualified me very, very well. I am totally partisan. I do not belong to his political party. And we were the immediate past government that he replaced. But having said so, I think truth is sacrosanct. I just ask the people, are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? I think that summarizes it all. Each time I come home, there's so much hue and cry about things not being well. And I come home very, very often, at least. So one gets the temperature of...
Are you mad with what is going on? Because we read it in the paper, we see everything. People are saying there's no salary for the civil servant. There are a lot of shenanigans going on. One of your senatorial aspirants recently spoke about her situation. She was almost killed. A female, I've just forgotten her name now. There are a lot of things going on. So what do you think is aching you about Kogi, your own state?
You see, one thing I must say, I cannot afford to be mad. We need to be very, very focused and very, very strategic in our thinking. It's quite clear to me now that the performance of the governor, good or bad, does not necessarily mean, doesn't necessarily translate to electoral fortunes or misfortunes. So many things come to play. The issue of how well you can fund an election, the issue of how well you can deploy hooliganism and brigandage, and the impartiality of the umpire. So these things come to focus. So we must be very strategic. What we can just keep on doing, and I think so many people are doing it very, very succinctly, is to highlight the anomalies we have in Kogi today. I am not on the payroll of Kogi State. Those who are on that payroll appreciate the misnomer and the irregularity of their salary pay. When we were in government, we got allocation for 47 months. At the end of the day, we were owing only 2 months' salary.
Are you sure?
Absolutely.
2 months?
2 months' salary, regardless of what anybody says. These are the facts. 2 months. And if we had been paid, because by the time we were leaving, the 48th allocation hadn't come. If we had been there, we would still have been owing just two months. There is no miracle about it. It just shows commitment of the government and the ability to communicate properly with the labor unions. We had problems. They had so many allowances they wanted.
They've been fighting for that.
But we said, look, in view of the paltry revenue stream and the allocation from Abuja, let us set aside some of these allowances now. Let us focus on the basic salaries and let's try and see how we can pay. And that we achieved through dialogue. And even at that, the labor still felt we weren't good enough. But today, if you ask them, are you better off today than you were 4 years ago? I'll be very interested in knowing what their response will be.
That's the people themselves.
Yes.
How are you seeing November 2? Do you think he can get it this time again? He's talking about second term, and November 2 has been fixed for the election for Kogi State and Bayelsa. Do you think Kogi people will genuinely vote, and do you think vote buying is going to play a role?
Definitely. That has become the new normal now. Vote buying, an umpire that is not impartial.
You're talking of INEC?
Yes. And the unleashing of the security apparatus on the citizenry. We saw it in Rivers State. We saw it here in Kogi State ourselves. So all these things are things that we must strategically look at for us to have half a fighting chance. But most importantly, what we in the PDP need to do is to look for a credible candidate that has a track record of performance, that people can readily appreciate the quality inherent in him, and then we have the resolve to do what is good for us.
But a lot of people are saying that, why can't they just throw Akita Yomiuni in the front? Have you not heard that? And why are they sluggish about that?
I'm hearing for the first time from you. there are some certain dynamics that come to play in this state. Nobody knows what may happen. A lot of meetings are going on, and look, at the risk of being branded not modest, I can tell you that I'm eminently qualified. But where we are now, we want the best person who can win.
The best person who can win. I'm hearing it for
you. Yes, the best person who can win. We have things like zoning to have a look at, the issue of population, and the disposition of the citizenry to that candidate. So all these things would come to a play.
Do you think someone like Dimelai is good for that? People are posturing for Senator Dimelai.
He is eminently qualified. He's a warrior. He's a fighter. He's enamored himself. He's endeared himself to the citizenry by the steps he has taken in the last 24 months fighting for the common man. That puts him in good stead.
Are you sure?
But we in Kogi West, we have fought so hard to make him to continue to be relevant in this nation. We stood against the attempt to recall him. We were able to return him as our senator against all odds. He will need to come back to the people and seek our permission if he wants to go higher.
Become governor of
Yes, he needs to come and have a dialogue with us. Yes.
What do you say about Senator Smart Adeyemi? A lot of people felt that he had a chance in the last election, senatorial zone here. What do you think worked against him? Some people feel it's pompous.
I have absolutely no comment to make about Smart Adeyemi. He's on a different race now, and I wish him well.
What do you wish Kogi State people? You are the former deputy governor and one of the leaders. Your father is a veteran, one of the most respected politicians in Nigeria and in Africa. What do you wish for your people? What do you want to see to make Kogi a new Kogi if you are to give him the chance?
Honestly, I sincerely hope and pray that the people of Kogi State, both in the West, the Central and the East, will open their eyes and think very, very well. Kogi State is on the cusp of changing what is happening to us now. It totally depends on the people. You see, there's so much suffering and misinformation. I just hope our people would step up to the plate and do what is best for them. Let us look at the candidates very, very carefully, look at their track record, and begin a process that can alleviate the woes that is besetting us now. Look, I'm not talking like a politician now. Anytime I come home, my house is, there's a deluge of people wanting assistance. How much can one man do? How much can one man do? Very, very little. We need government to intervene without playing games so that the lot of our people can begin to improve. Our people are not asking for Dubai, just basic needs. Look, we have been in government. I know it's very, very, very difficult. I'll be the last person to criticize this government along certain lines. But for basic needs, I think every government should be able to provide for basic needs for the people. Improvement in water supply, education. Look, when we were in a government, it's a given. Government took it as a responsibility to pay WAEC. In the light of not being able to do so many things for the schools, we felt, okay, let us take away this load from the students and the parents. It was a given. We were paying.
Basic.
Yes. But now, it's a luxury. So many other things. It was government's desire. Look, even the quality of life, the level of hooliganism and thuggery in this state is appalling. When we were in a government, it was eradicated. During our campaign and our voting, not one life was lost. Not one. That was the premium we placed on life here. But today, the new normal is shooting around. If people die, nobody talks about it. It's so sad.
Do you think the governor is too young to rule? A lot of people are looking at him as too young, but maybe it power fell on his lap so suddenly.
No. Definitely he's not too young to rule. Definitely he's not too rule. I would want to say maybe he was overwhelmed by the task, and he probably made the error of setting aside people who have institutional memory about governance in Kogi State, you can't just come and say anybody older than 40 or 50, you don't need them. As a deputy governor, the first thing I did was I called some very old civil servants to come and advise me. Pa Ailewu from Basa. He was the first secretary of the government in Kogi State. I invited him, and he told me that, look, this is the first time anybody is talking to him about Kogi. And I made sure he got onto the protocol list of the government, so that every event we were doing as government, he was invited. So many other people, you know.
That's democracy at the grassroots.
Yes, you must harvest this knowledge. There is no substitute for experience.
There's no substitute for experience.
None.
It's very unique.
None. Either in politics or in a marriage or even in a business. It's just that some experiences are not good. You must identify them and sidestep them. But you need to listen to people who are more experienced than you are. The governor is definitely not too young. It's definitely not
throwing out, they're throwing away experiences. The elder statement.
That is, I think, his biggest undoing, you know. And when you set aside people who are experienced, nurtured by education, interaction and engagement with the process, you know, they have a way of undermining you, even if they don't lift a finger, you know. Their silence is pregnant. And even at best, you are likely to have pitfalls. So once you push them aside, as the pitfalls come, they just chuckle and they watch you fall. Yeah,
just like that. I enjoyed this last part. Before I go, I would like to ask you on the larger perspective. Do you think democracy has failed Nigerians? Let me ask you this. When we are coming on the road, you see all the bad spots on the road. Sorry, sir. You see the bad spots? You see the even light is just slightly improving. That's power. And a whole lot of things is just going wrong. Insecurity. You just heard yesterday that the House of Reps has summoned the president to come and explain why there's killing everywhere, the herdsmen and all that. Do you think democracy has failed us? You as a son of a Democrat and an elder statesman who died thinking about Nigeria.
Honestly, democracy has not failed us.
Are you sure?
Yes. It is the operators of the democratic process that are failing us. It is so sad now that we are in a situation whereby democratic institutions are now being used to subvert democracy. You know, that for me is the biggest problem we have. You know, where democratic laws properly passed by the National Assembly, by the legislature, are being used to subvert democratic experience that we're going to go through. So democracy, I believe, is still the best form of government, no matter its imperfections. You know, it's just so worrying that the issue of vote buying is beginning to make nonsense of the concept of one man, one vote. You see, when you can buy a vote with 2,000 naira, my vote, you can't buy it for 20 million, because I'll be voting based on the issues and my understanding and the change I want. So that concept is just, and I think that's probably what informed the electoral college system in America. One vote is not the same. A vote in California is not the same as a vote in Maine, you know. So, but I'm not saying that's the best process. In fact, they are clamoring now to have one vote to mean one vote, you know. Yeah.
Basics.
Yeah.
Because of the realities.
Because of the level of their evolution, you know. Yes.
Last note, give advice to people that respect you, hold you in high esteem, people that see you as role model in Kogi State and outside Kogi State. What are you going to tell them? People that love your father and they are asking that, where is his son? He raised up very wonderful children. What happened? So what are you going to say to them?
Honestly, I really don't have much to say. The airwaves is full of advice to people. You know, but one refrain my late father used to always say, you must conduct your life with integrity. If you are in public office, conduct your tour of duty as if at the end of it all there is going to be a hostile inquisition, inquiry. You see, if you can live with that as a public officer, you are okay. Have at the back of your mind that there will be a hostile inquisition. You know,
hostile. Yes. That is very incisive.
A hostile one. Yes.
Of your tenor regime.
Yes. So apart from that, be fair to everyone. You know, but for Kogi State, please let us all come out and try and do what is right for our people by voting with common sense.